Our next speaker is going to come at us from a different angle, going to come at us from a different part of the world, actually. And I'm very excited to see what they have to say. Yihan Fang comes to us from Yirendai. She's the CEO of Yirendai, which is the online lending arm of Credit Ease. Credit Ease and Yirendai are two of China's most revered financial institutions, one very digital, another more of a offline lender, both very large and very successful. Yirendai is actually traded on the New York Stock Exchange under the ticker YRD, and you know, in the past 12 months, we've had a number of issues in our industry, of course. One in China was a company called Izubao, which was discovered to have been committing widespread fraud that had a material effect on Yirendai's stock. In fact, last summer, Yirendai was trading at about $3.50. Today, it's trading at over $25. Ms. Fang is going to explain to us her perspective on the wild and woolly China as we perceive it and what it's really like in reality. And then her colleague is going to join, and they're going to show us more about their product. So everyone, please welcome Ms. Yihan Fang.
US conferences, actually all of them I attended. I remember the first one in New York, that was a small room, but packed with people.
The mic is not on.
Today we have a huge room, but seems not packed yet. Yeah, I was telling a story. Let me just quickly continue. So the first LendIt I attended was 5 years ago in New York, and a small room, but packed with a lot of people standing. And today we have a huge room, but not very packed yet. But on the positive side, does that mean that our marketplace lending or fintech is more fragmented? Okay, today I'd like to share with you on our perspectives on fintech in China and also some opportunities and challenges for marketplace lending in China, and finally our offering to the industry. Our topic is From Big to Strong, China Fintech Entering New Era. Okay, here's a chart we made. Different areas of fintech in China are in different stages. Payment, it's like a leapfrog in China. In China, you don't have to bring any cash. Even street vendors, you can use mobile payment in China, which is totally different from here in the US. And for investment, online investment, although last year the volume has exceeded 400 billion, it's still a small portion of investable asset from Chinese individuals because Chinese people have a lot of money. Insurance is still young. Last year, the sales volume was like $55 billion. For financing, we categorize into two areas. One is online lending, where I will go into more depth next in the next slides. And we define it as healthier stage now. And for crowdfunding, I would say it's reshuffling. It's experiencing some difficulties while maybe needing more regulation over there. And if infrastructure has been developing pretty well, and the four areas, cloud, blockchain, credit scoring, and big data. Now let's zoom in to marketplace lending in China. Of course, lending is huge in anywhere in the world. And today, you think lending is big in China. But actually, if you look at outstanding balance of consumer finance market, for example, in 2016, online lending is only a small portion of that market size. And with the GDP growth and consumption in GDP, as well as financing, more and more financing needs, the growth rate of consumer finance market will be faster than those of developed countries. And we expect in 2019, it will be like 1,500 billion US dollars. And at that time, I think marketplace lending will have a bigger penetration in the whole market. Marketplace lending opportunities in China are not the same as in the US. In the US or other developed countries, most marketplace lenders are focusing on more efficiency and better customer service. They want to make lending a better experience. But in China, actually, financial services are many, many years behind. And people could not get financing, even if they have a good job and good status. So actually, in China, online lending is impacting the society in these ways, in addition to better experience and better efficiency. First of all, it's solving the financial needs for the underserved, huge underserved demand, where people, for people, getting access to money is the first priority. Second of all, credit awareness is not there yet. A lot of people, especially in third or fourth tier cities, are still borrowing from like friends and family or unprofessional lending services. So borrowing habits, for example, borrowing from mobile phone, that's a revolution of from nowhere to borrow to borrowing from mobile phone instantly. Lastly, China's credit infrastructure and credit system was not comprehensive. So online lending is helping to add more data into the system. But of course, there have been issues. You guys may have heard that in the past 2 years, there have been bad news in the industry. There were fraudulent platforms. There were embezzlement. No information closure. And some platforms disappeared. And the consumer rights got damaged a lot. On August 24th of 2016, the regulation body for online lending, Chinese CBRC, together with other government agencies, announced the first guidelines for marketplace lending. There were many, many rules. Among them, they addressed very, very important issues. I think they did a very good job working together with companies like us, as well as associations. And they came up with rules including platforms have to be intermediaries only. They cannot be like banks and do credit enhancement. And there has to be fund custodian. This is essential where companies cannot take customers' money away. And there's amount cap for each loan. And there are required disclosures. So from all these years, CreditEase has been in the industry for 11 years, and Yirendai has been there for 5 years. We defined the online lending three stages. From 2010 to 2012, it was emerging stage. And from 2013 to 2015, it's fast growing. And now you see the green bars. The bars are the number of functional platforms in China. 2016, and the number of platforms in 2017 are expected to be smaller, meaning many platforms will be consolidated or disappear. But we think it's optimizing stage. With the regulation in place, as well as many other innovations, the platforms are, will be existing, will be stronger, because the total volume of loan is still growing. So the red line is we divide the expected loan volume by number of platforms. So the average volume on each platform actually will be bigger. This is another indicator to look at the industry. The red line is the average return for investors. In early days, the return could be high as 20%. And we all know that for fintech, marketplace lending platform to function well and to last long, you cannot give that high of a return, and you disclose wrong information just to attract some uneducated investors for them to put money on your platform. So the average return has been dropping to now around 10%. So Yirendai was launched in 2012 by Credit East, was spun off as an online unit doing marketplace lending. Our segmentation for borrowers is urban salary worker. The reason we chose this population is because, one, they are good at credit, they have stable jobs, and they're young in their age. They have like big consumption needs. Secondly, it's very important because these people are internet savvy. They do a lot of things online. They shop online, they check their bank statements online, you know, they have their social security tax online, your phone bills online, a lot of data online. Because of lacking of credit infrastructure, bureau data, we actually could grab some of these alternative data online, which were very important to create a new online credit underwriting experience. Our investors are mostly online mass affluent. Technology innovations are key drivers for Yirendai. We actually launched the world's first mobile app, borrowing app. That app is not simply a, you know, lead generation app, but from an application to like approval to like loan payment, the whole process. That app was launched in 2013. And in 2014, we actually launched the first online fast track, meaning in a few minutes, we can instantly underwrite people and get money in their bank. That was like a huge revolution in China. At the beginning, we tested it, and we didn't know that actually mobile app, in addition to good customer experience, it also gave advantage, benefit to like risk, a lot of data for risk management, customer acquisition ways. So now if you go to App Store, you see a lot of like loan apps, but Yirendai was the first one, and most of our customers come from the app today. Also risk management and customer acquisition. Today, we have almost 500,000 borrowers acquired online, and how to source them efficiently is a big thing from different channel. So we focused on growth, but the quality is very important. Until Q3 2016, we have facilitated 3.8 billion loans, but our net charge-off rate and the customer acquisition cost has been in control. That's what we call quality of borrower acquisition. And for investors, we also look at average AUM. We want the investors to invest more and more. Today, our average AUM per investor is 12,000 US dollars, which has been increasing over time. That means people like to stay and invest more, which is a very important indicator because we want to get mass affluent investors only. We IPO'd on December 18th of 2015 in New York. And a year later, on the same day, our price went up pretty well. And we were the best performer among Chinese companies listed in the US. I was also told that we're actually the best performing technology IPO last year. But of course, now there's Snapchat. Good that they did an IPO in 2016. There were some international recognitions. So our goal for 2020, we already set this goal of 100 billion RMB, 15 billion US dollars. So with all the achievements that Yirendai and our fellow other companies, good successful companies, with all that, actually online lending is not easy in China. It's pretty hard. First, lack of credit awareness. We had to market the market a lot. And secondly, lack of the credit rating system, that made our risk management and pricing the risk pretty costly. Thirdly, lack of bureau data. I remember when I first learned from Lending Club and other US players, their most effective way of sourcing customers is direct mail. So I tried in China. I spent 100,000 yuan in Beijing to a community. I sent letters to them, and I got zero response. So direct mail didn't work because I didn't have the bureau data. I didn't know who to send to. I didn't know what FICO score customers have. So that's a big challenge on targeted marketing, because really financial services is for segmentation. You need to reach to the customers that need your service and that are good. And lastly, organized fraud. This is becoming bigger and bigger, and many online players got hit by organized fraud. They are kind of high tech. So with all these challenges, I like to save the best for last and pass the stage to my colleague, Mr. Yang Kao, our COO.
Thanks, Yihan. It's always hard to present after your CEO or CFO. They share great numbers and great news, and then say, hey, there's a problem, you've got to fix it. So with that, it's a great honor to representing Yirendai for at LendIt USA. So we would like to share with you a little bit what we think we see the industry is going in China, is fintech industry, and what we are doing to help. So we would like to introduce a platform. Before that, we reiterate what Yihan just said. We see the problems, and the problem of credit awareness and lack of data-driven rating system and the lack of bureau infrastructure, and there's definitely a large organized fraud. So in last 10 years, almost 11 years, Credit Ease has been operating in China from both online, then last 5 years with Yirendai, offline and then online, and been working on the P2P lending space, and been really, really pioneering and leading those innovations. So with that, and with great excitement, we would like to announce our Yirendai enabling platform. This platform is basically give our best technology we accumulated in last 10 years, and especially last 5 years with online at Yirendai, and with key focus on three areas. One is data, how to acquire, analyze, and organize consumer data. And the other thing is how to help the industry to do customer acquisition. As Yihan just mentioned, because there's lack of a bureau infrastructure, how do we target and advertise and offer to customer more effectively is really, really big problem for the industry. And then finally, it's anti-fraud. So as you can see, we here at Yirendai think fintech as two things. It's really a newer iteration of financial services driven and enabled by the technologies, including data technologies, machine learning, and infrastructure, and also more importantly, as you see last 5 years, really the pervasive of mobile applications. So with that, we think there's a time, and this is the right time, to really, really get in next wave of fintech innovation in China. So what we offer at this platform is really tested and proven technology, which we were already processing over 10 million loan applications. And we also have been very successfully managing our risk, as you can see from our quarterly reports. So this is test and proven technology from both data and also customer acquisition perspective. And we also offer very intelligent and accurate targeting and profiling of customers. And finally, we can help our partners to grow and drive their business forward a lot faster than they can do today, because there is a proven technology infrastructure for you. So that's what we see, the value of our enabling platform. The reason we call it enabling platform it's really, you think of this way, it's really we help us first, and we help our customers, and then we help our partners to offer more and better service for our customers. So as you can see, we'll go through the details, but fundamentally, we, with latest new data and machine learning and mobile and the infrastructure technology, we package them up and we apply what we already learned, and we build one next layer to be applicable to our partners, and especially during the case for lending and sometimes for customization, customer acquisition, for borrowing as for the investor as well. So we can go to each topics in a little bit more detail. From the data side, we actually use a lot of user authorized personal data, including their financial transactions, their phone bills, and their social records to build scoring and underwriting system. So we have the technology called Honeycomb. It's been in development, been in use for the last 4 years, has been very successfully. This is, I would say, ladies and gentlemen, the industry-leading technology to really, really grab user data, analyze, and organize it for risk and for fraud uses. So, and very adapt to the China market. So this is the thing. We definitely will think we're the best, and we would like to share with our selected partners. And we also have, as you can tell, Yihan just said, we have over 20 million registered users. We're going to reach 30 this year, very soon. And we cannot serve all of them. And we have our own risk appetite, we have our own selection criteria, but we know those users. So what we do, can we share with our partners? And maybe they have a better way of serving them. And but the key thing really, we know them. And it's very, very different than we just give you a phone number you can call. We have all the information necessary to profile this user. And with their permission, we can share with our partners. So that's on the borrower side. A similar thing is for the investor side. And we have over 4 million registered investors. And among them, and 800,000 have invested. And there are many, many opportunities we can offer to those invested or yet to be invested a better product, a product better suited for them. So we, because we know them, we can work with the partners to develop targeted, a better targeted offering. So, and then, as you said, heard you have mentioned fraud, and fraud is definitely a big issue, especially organized fraud, or a fraud, fraudsters backed by very high-tech organizations. So what we do, we develop a model where we start from, as soon as you launch our app, we start tracking you, which we know what your behavior during the loan application. And because we process so many applications, we build a very good machine learning model to decide whether you, as when you start the app, you have a high probability of fraud, then we give you a different path. And we ask you to go through a different set of questions. And we even ask you different questions. So we, based on your response, we can decide further whether you're fraud or not. So these type of technology is really, if you say cat and mouse game, and we definitely want to stay ahead of those organizations, but we think we're doing a very good job and would like to share those capabilities with our partners. So as we said, our goal, why we're doing this, is basically just by us driving the industry forward is not enough. We need to make the industry more efficient. So that's why we're opening up this platform with our partners. And as Abraham Lincoln famously said, the way to predict the future is to build it. So now with our partners, we'd like to build a future together. Okay, thank you very much.